Take me in your arms and hold me close.
This is a good place.
right here. Yes. To just lift your hands and lift your voices.
Hallelujah.
And give the Lord some glory.
Hallelujah.
Just tell him thank you for whatever it is that he has done.
Hallelujah.
How he's left you. How he brought you to this place.
Yes.
Safely through.
Yes.
Safely through.
Yes.
For those of you who are tuning in over social media, we thank God for you. We thank God for his presence, even in the place where you are. In this house, as we talked about last week, there is no fear.
Amen.
There's no fear for where we've been through, for what we've been through. Because sometimes you can look back at your journey and say, man, my God, you kept me. And then your heart starts racing. You think, this could have happened. And that, have you ever considered all the things that could have happened to you? And that would bring some fear. But instead of that, that's releasing our faith.
Yes.
We're exploding into the next dimension.
Hallelujah.
We are going even further.
If you,
wherever you are, whatever you're experiencing.
Yes.
Right here in this place, I'm not talking about 7,000 Franklin, I'm talking about in this place, in the place of challenge, in the place of sickness, in the place of fear, if you're dealing with it, in the place of your faith, in the place of lack, in the place of abundance, wherever you are in this very second, emotionally, this is a place to just declare, oh God, I'm going to bless you, oh God, I'm going to praise you.
Thank you.
Oh God, I'm going to lift you up.
Yes,
there's none like you. You know, just forget about who's with you.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Forget about who's standing next to you.
Hallelujah.
I want this to be an audience right now,
yes,
but just
God.
You,
you
and the Lord.
Yes,
that's
Lord.
It.
Yes,
and here he is asking you, what is it that I can do for you? What is it that
Hallelujah.
You want from me? And in this place,
Hallelujah.
Lord, just receive my worship.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Receive my worship. Receive my worship. Will you do that? Will you do that? Just go ahead. Close your eyes.
Hallelujah.
Lift your hands.
Hallelujah.
Lord, I surrender everything to you. Father, there is none like you. It's okay. You can open your mouth. It's all right.
Hallelujah.
I give you everything.
Hallelujah.
There is none like you, oh God.
Hallelujah.
There's none like you, oh God. None like you, oh God. Now I want you to bring up while you're talking, I want you to think about those things that have bothered you. Think about those things that have had you on your knees just crying out to God. Think about those things that just have no words. You don't even know what to say. Think about those things that have caused so much pain. So much pain. And if you're honest, even confusion, because you're trying to figure out, Lord, what is it that you're doing? What is it that you're doing? What am I supposed to be? Where am I supposed to be? What am I supposed to be doing in this very moment? Think about those things. And in those things, I want you to say, but Lord, I praise you. I lift you up.
I
magnify you. David said in the psalm, and Jesus quoted from David when he said, I've cried all night. And it's, why are you so far from my crying? Why have you turned away from me? Why aren't you responding to me? Then he said, but you are great. You are great. And you inhabit, you live, you dwell in the praises of your people. So I'm going to praise you in this place. I feel all by myself. I feel alone, but I'm going to praise you in this place because I know every promise, everything you said, it's already done because you spoke it. You spoke it thousands of years ago. You said that you would never leave me or forsake me. You would never walk away from me. You would never turn away from me. And I'm here with you. I'm here for you. And even though I don't feel you, even though I don't see you, I know you're there because you're not a man that you should lie. And you're not, you don't have to repent from anything. Everything you said, it already is. I don't need to feel it. I don't need to see it. I just need to know you said it. And because you said it, I know that it is. You're not alone.
Thank you.
Now he says, let the weak say I'm strong. Maybe you've been diagnosed with sickness in your body. He says, let the sick say that I am healed. You walk in divine health all the days of your life. I declare that right now in the matchless name of Jesus, that the healing virtue of the Lord Jesus Christ is manifested, is manifested in you and is flowing through your body. I am the healer. I am on top. That's what he says in Deuteronomy. On top only. I'm not beneath. The head and not the tail. I don't have to beg. I don't have to borrow. He says that I'm anointed to lend to nations. Do you believe that God is the God of more than enough?
Amen. Hallelujah.
Do you believe that his name is healer?
Amen. Hallelujah.
Do you believe that his name is even breakthrough? Bel-Perazim, he's the God of the breakthrough. Do you believe that?
Hallelujah.
Do you really believe that?
Hallelujah.
No, do you really believe that?
Hallelujah.
Do you believe that there is nothing, no thing too hard for our God?
Yes. Hallelujah.
Do you really believe that?
Thank you.
Go ahead and say, I believe it.
I believe it.
I didn't hear you. Say, I believe it.
I believe it.
There is nothing to it. What are the names that we call him?
Hallelujah.
What are the names we call him?
Jireh.
Okay. He's the God who sees and provides. What do we call him? We call him sanctifier. We call him deliverer. We call him healer. What are some of the things that we call? So we call him names according to what he's done. But I want you to know something this morning, that he's bigger than any experience you've ever had.
Hallelujah.
He's greater than your past.
Yes.
He's bigger than your future.
Yes.
He is God. But here's the thing. We call him. He says, I'm calling you by my name.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I'm calling you by my name.
Hallelujah.
Everything that I am to you,
thank God,
I've empowered you to be
to
this world.
Thank you, Lord.
That's the one I'm saying. We can thank him.
Thank you, Lord.
We can thank him. Can you just take about just 30 seconds, just 30 seconds, and just magnify the name of the Lord. Just worship him however you want to do it.
Hallelujah.
If you want to clap your hands, if you just want to cry out, if you just want to talk to him, just 25 more seconds.
Thank you, Lord.
And just worship him.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. You are worthy to be praised. There is no one like you, Lord. There is no other God like you, Lord Jesus. Nothing is impossible for God.
Let your glory reign, God.
You may wait when there is no way, Lord.
Let your glory reign.
Hallelujah.
Let your glory reign.
You move mountains, God. You are a way maker. You're the healer. Hallelujah. You are the promise keeper, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Worthy to be praised, Jesus. How you way, Lord Jesus. How you way, my God.
Wherever you are, if you came in with a person and you're good with holding their hand or touching them, then you do that. Otherwise, I just want you to look and begin to declare into somebody's life. Begin to declare in their life. Begin to speak blessings over them. What is it? What is it? What's coming up? What's coming up now in your spirit? Begin to declare that. Begin to declare that. I declare that you have entered into your wealthy place, a place of supernatural abundant overflow, not just financially, even in your relationship. I declare now, and I set my faith in agreement with the prayers that you've been praying concerning your house.
Glory!
I declare that right now.
Hallelujah.
I declare that they are well.
Hallelujah.
I'm praying about their emotions and their mental health. I declare that the Lord has said he has heard your prayer.
Hallelujah.
I set my faith in agreement with you now.
Thank you.
You don't have to worry about even finances. You don't have to worry about any of that. Thank God that everything you set your hands to do, you want to find good. Not just success, but good success. This is the day that you have set your heart to serve and to pursue God. Even as the apostle declared, he said, I have been apprehended by the thing I was trying to apprehend. You've been in pursuit of God, truth, and peace. This is the day that he's apprehended.
Thank you, Father God.
Thank you.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Glory. Go ahead and put your hands together.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Rest in your seats. If you so desire, you can shout, hey, to somebody. We bless the name of the Lord in this place. It's so good to see you. It's so good to see you. There's been so much happening. I met another brother last night, and it's as though he's been my brother throughout all eternity. I believe that the Lord has been waiting from his first thought to create this universe, from the very first thought. I love quoting from Maimonides, that Hebrew scholar, but he said that if it was possible for God to have one thought, then the instant he had the first thought, he thought of everything. So he saw this very moment in time where he was going to bring the Ruach. That's like breath. The breath of God. The Holy Spirit. Glory to God. Clay and Rochelle, I thank God. I call you special guests. Well, I said that, special guests. I said it, right? Okay, that's the last time you're going to hear me say that, because now you're family. It's already out. This is family. So I thank God that you're here, and even for my brother and my sister, the deacon. If those of you who have been listening to or following on Facebook and YouTube, and you've been listening to the series on the kingdom, I talked about being diplomats. I talked about this experience that we had golfing, and we had about 12-13 people. You know, you're only supposed to have a maximum of 4. But we had about 12-13 people. Folks behind it, and we was hitting the ball all over the place because none of us could play then. Taking up time, and we're just having fun. Okay, it's only been 30 minutes and we're still on the first hole. So people are complaining, right? We get to the second hole, the third hole, whatever it was, and the marshal comes out because they've called the clubhouse. The marshal comes out and says, oh, you're going to need to do this. And I told the marshal, I said, people complain, I'm sorry. We're just out here to have a good time. This man here is from the United States Embassy, and I gave him the name of the country. I said, well, he works with this ambassador, and he is a diplomat. And as soon as he heard where this man is connected, the country that he's connected to, the land he has come from, and that he's a representative of that kingdom in this place, the marshal apologized.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
He apologized. And he said, oh, sir, if you had just let us know that you were here, there would have been no trouble, no complaints. You enjoy your round of golf. Broke all the rules because you're only supposed to have 4. We had about 3 times the amount. And all of the people who were behind us just disappeared. No more complaints. They moved them someplace else, put them on another, on the bigger course. But my thing is that all he needed to hear was that this man is a diplomat. And because there was a diplomat among us, those of us who were with him was now operating in the authority and favor of the diplomat. And he needed somebody to testify for him because he wasn't going to do it. So when somebody testified for him, everything that was coming against the people who were walking with them disappeared.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
And I said that for the kingdom, because we're kingdom citizens. Amen. Because we're kingdom citizens, and we identify that what the kingdom is.
Yes.
You remember what the kingdom of God is, the kingdom, what it means. And we talked about the 3 parts. I won't go through all of that, but when it comes to the citizens or the ecclesia or the ecclesia, what we call church, the ecclesia are the those who are handpicked by the king. Handpicked by the king to execute the judgments or the desires of the king in this new place, in this new territory. So it's not a religious organization. The church has nothing to do with religion and everything to do with political power and position and presence. You can't be a prophet and not have a voice outside of the four walls.
Come on.
You can't be apostolic and nobody knows who you are, because you're not involved in community. You're not involved in politics. We work for the king.
Amen.
We work for the king.
Amen.
And because we work for the king, we operate in the authority of the king.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And everything, everybody, every challenge just needs to hear you say who you are.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And we don't testify for ourselves, so, you know, so we have a witness. That's what you call power right there.
Amen.
You hear that? Back up. Back up. I know what it is. I got two mics going. All right. All right. All right. Okay. Yeah, so we have the Holy Spirit, who is the witness. And he testifies for us.
Amen.
He testifies for us. He testifies for you. Aren't you glad that it's the Holy Spirit who testifies for you?
Amen.
I'm glad. Amen. I'm glad we don't have to, you know, tell him what it is that he needs to say. I was supposed to be doing something else, but you know what? We're just going to go with this, all right? I told you last week, in our first week back, our first day back, I said, listen, you know, for those who are taking their time about coming, that's fine. We're good with that. We're okay. But there's some things that we're just figuring out.
Amen.
So you know what? I really love the flow anyway, but it's great to understand that the Holy Spirit is testifying for me. And he reminds me. See, he's not here for me to speak in tongues. I don't need the Holy Spirit for that. All I need is a Rosetta Stone. And I can speak in another language, so it's not about that. Get this, the Holy Spirit isn't even here for me to cast out devils. That's not his job. To heal the sick, don't need the Holy Spirit for that.
Amen.
Go ahead, breathe.
Amen.
That's not what he's here for. Jesus tells us that in Mark chapter 16. He said, these signs follow them that believe.
Amen.
Shambach said, all you need is faith in God.
Amen. Hallelujah.
So the folks before the Holy Spirit even showed up, they were already casting out devils and healing the sick and raising the dead and doing miracles. Peter walked on water and he just had a little bit of faith.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
He was still cussing folks out and carrying his weapon. And he's walking with Jesus.
Amen.
And we have a heart attack when somebody who loves Jesus. Oh, come on, y'all.
Hallelujah.
You ain't never said something?
Not you would say.
Yeah. Well, I'm not telling you that it's acceptable. It's okay, you know, because there's our language, our tongue is going to change.
Yes, Lord, it sure is.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But Peter walked with Jesus, and they were doing all of these things. And it wasn't until Jesus said, I'm getting ready to leave. I'm finished. I'm getting ready to leave. But then, like, no, hold up. You can't leave us now. Man, we're just getting going. It's just getting good. We're getting used to this. I'm starting to walk in this place. Man, I know who I am when I'm with you.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And see, Jesus is like, I don't want you to just be with me.
No.
I need you to be me.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
And as long as I'm here in this place, you can. Mm-hmm. I have to go. He says, well, I'm going away and I'm going to prepare this place for you. That where I am right now, See, when Jesus walked the earth, he walked the earth as the Son of God. Where I am in this position, in this place, Son of God, that's a position. This is where you're going to be.
Amen.
But I have to go for you to get here.
Right. Amen. Amen, Jesus.
I'm going to prepare a place for you.
Amen.
Then he talks about in his Father's house. He says, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. A lot of folks say, okay, well, that means that we get to heaven, we're going to have a mansion full of rooms and space. No, that's actually talking about people, souls. There's plenty of us that's going to be connected. Man, I would really like to mess with some theology right about now, but I won't. Okay, you know, show us the Father. Two, when you see me, you see the Father.
Amen.
In the Father, we're one.
Amen.
We're the same.
Hallelujah.
See, Jesus came to reconnect us to the way it was in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Proverbs is 19 to 21, somewhere around there where he says that many are the devices of man's heart, but it says that the counsel or the purpose or the original intent of the Lord will always prevail.
Amen.
What was his original intent for us when we got here? Okay, let's
look.
Oh, there you go. There you go. There you go. Genesis chapter 1. I won't be too long, y'all.
Take your time.
Ooh. You heard that, right? How many of you are in agreement? You want me to just take my time?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Okay.
Bring it.
Tell them where. Tell them what happened in Africa. Tell them what happened. Yeah. Okay. Verse 26, chapter 1. This is one that we're going to look at anyway, but. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. And let them, who's them? Man, us, have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the book of John chapter 4, verse 24, thereabouts, Jesus says to the woman at the well, he says, listen, God is a spirit.
Yeah.
And they that worship him must worship him how?
Spirit.
Yeah, that's the only time when he tells us how to worship. That's the only time. He says, just do it in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
So then man was made in the image of God. That's a spirit. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it. And have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Chapter 2, verse 7, he says, and the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living nephesh, or a living soul. So man was made in the image of God. That's your spirit. That's the real you. And then he made a house. This is kind of where we left off, too. He made a house for the spirit to live in. That's the body that we see. And it's that body that we see that received a gender assignment. Because it's got purpose. Your spirit has purpose. So the purpose has to be fulfilled, but the spirit cannot operate in this realm without legal authority.
Amen.
The legal authority comes because the spirit was given a body. So the body is now my legal access. But my body needed some help. It needed some help. It needed to be able to see. It's like making some Kool-Aid. You got the water, you got the Kool-Aid. Okay, most of us, and I'll just say most folks even watching, growing up, if you had fried chicken with your dinner, Some people will tell you, depending on the type of meat, that's the kind of wine that you're supposed to have. What kind of wine should you have with chicken or fish? What color should the wine be?
White.
White wine? See, I was all messed up. Okay, so what are you supposed to have red wine with?
Steak.
Steak? Oh, the beef. Okay. All right, so no chicken. Okay, but beef. We're having some beef. There was 13 of us. We didn't have a lot of beef. We had chicken. Or eef, you know, whatever it was. Eef, don't ask eef what it is. But you got your beef. What color Kool-Aid did you make?
Red.
Red Kool-Aid. I was going someplace. Okay, so you got the water and you got the Kool-Aid. The water, that's the spirit. The Kool-Aid, that's the body.
Right.
You ready to drink it?
Yes.
Are you?
No.
It's missing
sugar.
Sugar, that means that now the body's going to receive it well. And it's going to be able to do its job because it's going to be rejected if it's got no sugar. I don't want it.
Amen.
Right. I'm not going to be able to operate in my purpose. I'm not going to be able to go through the communities. I'm not going to be able to touch the lives. I'm not going to be able to add to you if I don't have the sweetness.
Amen.
I've got to be able to know how to do that. So then the spirit was given a body for it to have legal access, but then the body was given a soul. That's the sweetness.
Amen. Hallelujah.
So to know how to flow, how to do. And everybody, each one, the spirit, the body, and the soul, each one has a purpose. The spirit has a purpose that comes from God. It's his purpose. It's his purpose. That's why everything has got to work together for the good, for those who love the Lord, who are the called according to his purpose. So he has a reason for you being here. That's your spirit. But the spirit had to have a body. And now the body just wants to survive to ensure that the spirit can do its job. I need to get you from this place to that place. That's why sometimes you start feeling desperate. And I don't even know why I'm feeling desperate. I don't even know why I'm feeling anxious. Because my spirit man has got a job, has got an assignment. And my body is responsible, was created to make sure that my spirit fulfills its assignment. But now the body needs some help.
Amen.
I'm a soul man.
All right.
Come on, Buster. I'm a soul man. I'm going to get my son to write a song. You got to give me some music on that one. I'm a soul man. Somebody tell somebody next to you. Just say, I'm a soul man. Okay. Well, we're going to do that too. Okay. So, and that's interesting, because man just simply is created. Adam, created, or human, you've been created. You've been created by God. You're created. That's really just your spirit. We become male and female because of the body. But when you're called of God and you're given a gift, the ability, some would say that you can't preach if you're a woman. Can't preach. That's reserved for men. It says so in the scripture. Yeah, but you just got to keep reading.
Amen.
You got to keep reading. You'll find in Corinthians, then in Timothy as well, that Paul was actually rebuking them. What? For such saith the law. What? So Paul said, are you the apostle or am I? He's rebuking. And Timothy, you read, somebody was just telling me this. He said, he wanted to debate, and I told him I don't debate the word of God.
Amen.
All right, all right. Hallelujah.
I don't have time for that. That's foolishness to me.
Amen.
True. I'm not your opponent, man. We're on the same team.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, but they announced that I was actually in the studio, the radio station. I'm on the air twice a week answering all biblically based questions, right? And so they said, well, Dr. McGee is actually at the station, and people start calling in. Well, I want to come in, and we're going to have a conversation. I want to debate. And then some of the folks from the radio station were saying, okay, well, you know, let's set this up. I said, I don't want to do any of that. I just came here to visit. I'm right here, and before I know it, people are walking in.
Oh, wow.
And this man, this gray-haired man with this big Bible and this big cross, I guess that means that he's right because he got a big cross around his neck. And he comes in and people are now, and I said, I'm just really here just to visit, take care of some business. I don't have my Bible, nothing. He sits down and everybody sits down around him. He starts in on me. And I said, sir, I don't want to debate. Not going to. He says, well, the word of the Lord says this. Now, if you can show me where I'm wrong, then I'll change. I said, you didn't come in here to change. You don't want to hear the truth.
Come on.
So he starts reading. And he said, I got two scriptures. And I said, yeah, I know it's two you have. And I gave him the scriptures. I said, well, go ahead and read them, sir. And so he's reading. And he starts with where a woman is prophesying or praying in public that she is to have her head covered. And he goes down to let her keep silent in church. Let her ask her husband if she has any questions when she gets home. And I said, okay, that's what you have. And I said, well, sir, according to what you just read, either you're right and the Bible's wrong, or the Bible is right and you're wrong. Okay, so you're saying that a woman is not supposed to speak in public. He said, that's what the word says. I said, no, read the first part again, where it says that when she's speaking in public, to cover her head. So there's something else that's going on. You got to understand the culture. So I lived in Arabia for a year. And I've been out in public places, even at McDonald's in Arabia, the women weren't permitted to order the food. There were three places for them to eat, three lobbies, three, dining areas, and McDonald's, at all the restaurants. There's one in the front, and you only see men. There's one in the middle, where you see men and their families. And the one in the back, you don't really see, but it's the women and children. So if the man decides, hey, I just want to talk to my friends, then your wife and children got to go in the back where nobody can see them. But if you want to just eat with your wife and your children, then you go in the center. Now, if you're in the front and she's in the back, and she can't come out and interrupt, but she can send a message, hey, ask your dad, or, trying to get your attention. I said, and that's the way that the houses, the places where they were worshiping, that's the way that it was set up. And so the men were in the front, the men and their families were in the center, but the women and children are in the back. So if she's in the back of the room and PA system. There you go. And it says, so if she couldn't hear what the preacher said, she just asked, okay, what did he say? And he says, okay, well that was it. I said, well, it hasn't changed because this is your argument. I'm just telling you, this is the reason why this was written. Well, God ain't gave no woman a word. So he didn't.
Lord,
I said, okay. I said, so I don't have my Bible. And I said, sir, can you turn to 1 John chapter 5? Because now it's on. Because you just, So I'm still not debating. I'm actually doing something on my phone. But I'm so just turn to 1 John chapter 5. Verse 7, what does it say? So go ahead and read it out loud. There are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, and he said, the Son. He said, no, it doesn't say Son. Because there was no Son then. It says, the Father, the Word, and the Spirit. And so we turn now to the book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 1. What does it say, verse 1? It says, in the beginning was the Word. Now, I'm just telling him while I'm doing something on my phone. Now, he's sitting, and I'm looking at him kind of, and everybody's just, okay, waiting for him to come back. It says, in the beginning was the Word. Word was God. Word was with God. Same as in the beginning with him. It says, verse 2 says, all things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. In him was light. Light shined in darkness. Darkness comprehended. And now, there's a man sent from God whose name is John. John was not that light, but he sent to bear record of him. And I went down to verse 11. I said, are you there? You there? Verse 11, it says that he came into his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become sons of God. That's in verse 12. It says, but these were the ones who were not born of the will of man or the will of blood, But they were born of the will of God.
Come on, Pastor.
Now look at verse 14. That's where I wanted to get you to. Now he's gone from this to this. So in verse 14 it says that the word was made flesh.
Come on, Pastor.
And dwelt among us, and we beheld the glory as of the Father, full of grace and truth. And so that's when Jesus came into the scene. But so then, would you agree that Jesus is the Word? And he said, yes. I said, sir, can you tell me how the Word got here in human form?
Come on.
Go to Luke. Oh, so a messenger from God came to this 13-year-old girl. Or considered woman because she was now past the flower of age, meaning she was having a cycle and she can get pregnant. And said that the Holy Spirit is going to overshadow you. He's going to take what we were calling the Word, but it requires to be a seed in order to connect with the egg that only the woman can produce. So now the seed, which is the Word of God, is going to be placed in the womb of the woman. The Word of God was going to be delivered or placed in the womb of the woman. And the woman is going to receive the Word. And for 9 months, that woman is going to develop the Word. And at the end of that development, the woman is going to produce the Word to the world so that that Word can change everything.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And I said, but I'm not finished. Mm-hmm. The Word lived 33 and a half years.
Come on now.
The Word performed miracles, cast out devils, did preach the kingdom. The Word did all of these things. And at the end of his time, the Word we call Jesus, Yeshua, he died on a cross. There were 9 women who went to his tomb to anoint his body.
Hallelujah. Mm-hmm.
Where were the men? Mm-hmm. Oh, they were hiding. Okay. Oh, all right. But there were 9 women. Did you know what I've noticed? I'm just throwing this out there. You know, how many dads, okay, so fathers, you know, so you know what I've noticed is that when our children or something's going on in public, we're like, okay, we're gonna handle this. When I get you away from all of these witnesses. But mamas,
right there.
They will go off with, see,
right there
in public.
Anyway, that's right. I don't care who's watching.
We'll fuss at you.
Yeah.
Now, we know better than to fuss at our wives in public.
Yes, you do.
You know, I fuss at my wife a lot when she's not home. Can't hear it. Don't repeat it either. I know better. So the thing is, that the women were there, they went to anoint his body. They went to anoint him. They may have gone for the wrong reason, but they went.
Yes.
And they saw him. They saw him. And they spoke to him first.
Amen.
And he spoke to them.
Yes.
And he gave them a message.
Hallelujah. Jesus.
I've risen. Can anybody tell me what the gospel message is?
Go and tell.
He's risen. Yeah, he's risen. He's alive. Jesus, he's alive. And then he told them, go and tell my men.
Right.
By definition of the word, what does apostle mean? Oh, one who is sent by Christ. To do what? To preach the gospel. What's the gospel? The good news. What's the good news? He's risen. So not only, sir, did a woman receive the word, develop the word, and then produce the word, not only did that happen, but when the word, Jesus, was resurrected, the women spoke to him and received instructions from Jesus and were the first ones to carry the gospel message.
Hallelujah.
Don't tell me God ain't never gave no woman no word. That's how the word got to the earth.
Hallelujah.
He won't talk no more. I don't get it. He's ready to leave, and he said, he's telling the other pastors that are out there, I'm just trying to get out. He says, man, they threw me to the wolves. I said, brother, ain't no wolves in there. I'm not a wolf. And you know what? I'm no longer a sheep. Now he's confused. What do you mean? Because he didn't say, now are we the sheep of God. That's the beginning. I'm not even a child. The Epistle of John, I think it's 2 John, the 2nd chapter around verse 15, he says, I'm writing to you as children because you no longer sin. So as long as we're talking about the issue of sin, we're just children. But he says, I write to you as fathers because you know him.
Amen.
Young men because you've seen him. So we're going to go through this stage. So as long as we're trying to deal with our sin issue, we ain't going to get nobody delivered because we can't even deliver ourselves. So we're still stuck on sin.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
What did we say last week sin is? Anybody remember? It's worth $5.
Self.
If you get it right, I'm going to let you give me 3 times that amount. Self-inflicted nonsense. Self-inflicted nonsense. Sin doesn't have any rule over us. That's a wrong sin. He doesn't control us anymore. I'm in control. Still messing with some theology. I know somebody's going to have a hard time with this one. Because I hear it said all the time, God's in control. I'm not going to ask you whether you agree or disagree. I'm just going to tell you what's next. Because we already read it in Genesis 1 where he says, I'm giving you control over everything. You want to know why some of your prayers don't get answered?
Come on.
I got faith. I fasted. Come on, am I talking to anybody?
Yes.
God, why aren't you answering my prayers? It's like you telling your child something. And maybe you've never done this. You told your child, you gave him some instructions, and you told him what to do, and then you're saying, okay, why need you to take care of this for me?
Huh?
Have you ever just looked at your child?
Yes.
Okay, husbands, you don't, okay, just keep looking forward. Has your wife ever said anything to you? I'm talking bad. My wife ain't in here.
Yeah.
Oh, but she's going to watch this. Yes, dear. So, has you ever been fussed at? And you can think of a million things you want to say right then, but you just keep looking forward? Straight face. Boy, I can't say it. And if I look too hard, she's going to know what I'm thinking, and then she's going to fuss at me about what I'm thinking.
Yes.
And I can't tell her if she's right or wrong. I can't agree, and I can't even apologize too quick, because that just makes it worse. Yeah, 40 years ago, I said, I'm sorry. But I said it at the wrong time. I said it when she was just getting started, you know. And so, you know, but I realized, okay, I'm wrong. I said, you know, baby, I'm sorry. That's right, you sorry. You sorry this, you sorry that. I'm sorry. I married you sorry. You know, I said 40-something years ago.
Oh,
we're going to be 41 years this year.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
I'm just telling you the truth, y'all. Come on, man. I'm just telling you the truth. So from that point on, I'll apologize, but I ain't sorry. I ain't sorry, nothing. I ain't gonna tell her that.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so you just look and you don't say anything. Have you ever done that? I ain't saying nothing to you. You know I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about God. We get upset because he's not saying anything because he's already told us what to do.
Right.
And we're not applying the principles that he's already given us. And he says that it will work But you have to work it.
Right. Hallelujah.
You got to do
Thank
it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Dad, I need you to do my chores this morning. You know, I'm kind of busy, so I need you to make my bed. What? I ain't saying nothing. I don't even hear you. Okay. You got somebody else pulling that out. Anybody need to hear that? Three people?
Amen. Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Let me finish this real quick. I'm going to take at least 5 minutes. Is that okay?
Okay.
Then I'll be finished with my introduction. I'm just kidding. All right. Because I guess we actually been talking about it already. There's so much that the Lord has for you, but we have to get beyond this message of salvation in order to experience it.
Amen.
We're going to start operating differently when you find out that the stuff that you've been waiting for is already yours.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And really, all you need is faith in God. Now, the Holy Spirit is an earnest or a down payment. That's great. Mm-hmm. That's great. You know, in Mark chapter 4, when Jesus talked about sowing seed, he says that you're going to reap or you're going to get a return off of that. Some, what was the first number? Anybody remember? Was it 40, some 60, and then some 100-fold?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, or 30, 60, 100-fold. So two things happen. If you're only getting a 30% return off of your seed, then that means that you're uncovering 70% of it.
Amen. Amen.
All right.
You got to cover the word with the word, more word, Father, you said, and then you just stay on that.
Mm-hmm.
But 30%, that's just your salvation. That's when you get born again.
Amen. Hmm.
That's Passover. We go from Passover to Pentecost to the most holy place, or the Festival of Tents, the Holy of Holies. Passover, we come through at the East Gate, the East. That's where the altar is. That's where the blood is applied. You hear people praying about the blood? I apply the blood like the devil's afraid of the blood. No, the blood is just salvation. That's when you get saved. That's Passover.
Amen.
Then you go from Passover at the outer courts to the inner courts. When you get to the, you got pieces of furniture in there, but we stop at the basin, and so the priest can wash, and you have your table of showbread and the candlesticks and all of this stuff. But that represents power, place of power. That's Pentecost.
Mm-hmm.
So we go from Passover, that's 30%, to Pentecost. But that's not the Pentecost is down payment. I know some people who said the Lord blessed them with this vehicle. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, okay, so you said that that's a miracle because both you and your wife just got laid off. And you got this expensive vehicle where your payments are $1,500 a month. This was about 25 years ago. $1,500 a month, and you got no job, you got no income, and you're saying the Lord blessed us, but we had a down payment. You put $10,000 on a vehicle that you're believing God was going to, if he's going to give me the vehicle, then I can keep that $10,000. So you came up with $10,000, put down a down payment on the vehicle, but you weren't going to be able to keep it. There's got to be more. Tell somebody that. Just say, it's got to
be
more. So you go from the Passover, that's salvation, little children. We get the blood. The blood is shed. The blood is shed not for us, but the blood is shed on us. The blood belongs to God. So we now qualify to be one with him when the blood is on us. So we're covered by the blood. We get washed and we're delivered. All these things happen. But that's just salvation. We don't stay in a place of salvation. We need to go in further. We need to get to that earnest. We need to get to that inheritance. We need to get to that promise. And that's the Holy Spirit, the promise of the Father. That's the down payment, or even an engagement ring. The down payment, the engagement ring. So the Holy Spirit is the engagement ring that tells everybody, I belong. But this one says, to Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit. He's not here for you to speak in tongues. He's not here for you to preach the kingdom. He's not here for you to heal the sick, raise the dead, give sight to the blind, to cure the lepers. He's not here for that.
Right.
Jesus tells you what he's coming for. Because this journey is going to be difficult. So he tells us in John chapter 14, beginning around verse 17, he says that he's going to comfort you. Mm-hmm. That means I'm going to be lonely sometimes. I'm going to be going through, but the Holy Spirit is here to talk to me when nobody else can or will. There's some conversations that I'd love to have with you, but I don't even know how to articulate it, but the Holy Spirit knows how to understand it, how to interpret it.
Amen.
And so I need the Holy Spirit because I can't do this on my own. And then he's going to remind me of everything that Jesus said. Because it's spoken, the Holy Spirit heard it, so he's going to remind me of it, and now I can speak it. And he's even going to, when you go into John chapter 16, it says that he's going to lead me and guide me into all truths. Then in Corinthians, he says that he's going to show me where the things are that eyes haven't seen and ears haven't heard, and it's never entered into the hearts of men. Verse 10 of chapter 1, of chapter 2, it tells us in 1 Corinthians, it says that, but these things has he revealed to us by the Spirit. So the Holy Spirit then is going to show us where those things are. He's going to have conversations with us that nobody else can have. I love Jude. And Judy says that he's going to keep me from falling.
Amen.
And present me faultless.
Amen.
Wait a minute, dude. Go ahead. So you're going to keep me from falling. But even the righteous fall seven times.
Right.
Yeah, dude, but because of the Holy Spirit, he gets you up, dusts you off.
Yes.
And your past is erased.
Yes. Hallelujah.
One of the things about love is that because he loves us in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we call that the love chapter, right? Okay, so beginning at verses 4 through 8, he's talking about this, and he says, but one of the things that love does is it keeps no record of wrongdoing.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Uh-oh.
No
record.
Hallelujah.
Don't remind you.
Just keep looking forward. I'm telling you, just keep looking forward. How do you have this instant recall? How do you remember everything I've ever done wrong? Maybe I thought you'd love.
Come on, yes.
Keep looking forward, I'm telling you. Don't say amen right there, brothers. I thought you loved me. How do you keep your record? How do you keep, did you ever wonder how David was the apple of God's eye? If there was ever somebody who screwed up or messed up,
mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
It was David.
Yeah.
Right?
Amen.
But God told Solomon, he says, as long as you walk upright before me like your father David did. David did everything I told him to do. What about Moses? He told Joshua the same thing about Moses. He says that Moses was a righteous man. He did everything I told him to do. He kept all my commandments. Well, how is it that tell me again, how come he can't go to the promise? Didn't he do something that you told him not to do, and he didn't do what you told him to do? He messed up, but you're saying that he did everything.
Yes.
What is this? So Jeremiah tells us that he's loved us with an everlasting love.
Amen.
With an everlasting love, with an everlasting love. Love keeps no record of wrongdoing because he loves them, and because they repented. When you repent, everything is erased. Oh, wait a minute. He goes back to that salvation thing in Psalm, the things around 108, where he says, as far as the east is from the west.
From the west. Yeah.
You remember that? As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our sins from us. Oh, okay. So you come through the east gate. You come through the east gate, folks. This is just happening, all right?
Right.
Has nothing to do with the stuff that... Okay, so you come through the east gate, and when you get to the east gate, first thing you get is the altar. You got the altar, and that's where the blood is going to be spilled. And that the blood is going to be spilled. And then once it's spilled, the priest will walk through it in a figure eight. They walk through it in a figure eight because eight is not just a new beginning, but you have two circles, which is infinity. So it's going to be whatever the sin was, is no more. It's been remitted. Wow, okay. So it's been remitted. Got another download. Somebody's connecting this. Okay, so it's been remitted. So, but then I don't stop there, where now I don't have the sin. It's not connected to me anymore. Now I go in further and I receive the Holy Spirit. That's Pentecost. Pentecost is a place of power. Power, what the Holy Spirit is coming to do. Not only is he going to remind us and he's going to comfort us, he's going to remind us of all the things that Jesus said. Not only is he going to reveal to us the will of God, the plan of God, the purpose of God for our lives. Not only is he going to lead us and guide us into all truths and keep us from falling and present us faultless and then testify on our behalf whenever we're accused. Mm-hmm. He's going to give us power.
Amen.
Well, what's this power? He tells us in Acts. To be witnesses.
Amen.
Amen.
So we can soul win. God cannot resist a soul winner who worships.
Oh, hallelujah.
To be witnesses for us, well, for him, in our home, in our community, in our state, to the uttermost parts of the world. The Holy Spirit is going to give me that? Yeah, I'm going to be able to testify. He's going to use me. And then there's going to be a boldness because he's going to remind me. How does he keep me from falling? Does he stop me from doing it? No. He reminds me of the word. He starts speaking to me. Don't do that. Now, Jerome, you need to go left. Keep looking straight ahead.
Amen.
I can tell him myself and y'all would say, okay, man, that's really messed up, man. Okay, I know this man. Brothers, just keep looking forward. I know this man who was walking with his wife and child. And this beautiful woman was walking toward him. And she's looking at him. And he kind of looks, see his wife. But see, dude, before you even saw her, your wife already checked her out. She already knows what kind of shoes she's wearing. She's checked out her makeup. She knows everything about her. She knows she got a freckle behind her left ear. She knows all of that already. I'm just telling you, I don't know how they do that. If they're making it up, I don't know. Got me scared. I'm convinced. So I'm just, the Holy Spirit is saying, don't do it.
That's right.
Don't do it. Okay, because y'all disappointed, huh? Now, so the Holy Spirit, come on, sis, it's all right. Yeah, so she's walking closer. And she's looking and smiling. She's almost as beautiful as my wife. And now she's looking hard and it's obvious. So I said, okay. I'm sorry, 33rd came back. 33rd came up, you know, Sac High, 70, you know, Cool Breeze, you know, Afro. You remember where you remember all this, you know, so it came back and you know, so I'm now just walking out, now I'm walking. Yeah. And she's looking, and then the dude she's with, he looked at me like, and for a second I forgot that I was, you know, with my wife. You know, this was years ago. All right, about 15. But I forgot that I was with my wife for a second when the dude, he looked at me like, and I threw my chest out like, what?
Yeah.
And then I remembered, oh, you know. Okay, but as she's passing by, the Holy Spirit starts speaking to me, said, don't do it. Because she already made eye contact, and the Holy Spirit saying, don't do it. We're, you know, she's passing and she's still looking. And he's saying, don't do it. You already know what you don't do, right?
Yeah.
You don't look back. Oh, I listen to the Holy Spirit. Don't get me wrong, I listen to him. But I'm just telling you. Because dude over here was saying, man, you got to see what it is.
That's right.
You got to see. It's too much for you. Okay, I'm just telling you the truth. Okay, so in my flesh, Paul said, there dwells no good thing. All right, and so I didn't do it. I just kept walking like it was nothing. And my wife said, she was pretty, huh? I said, who was pretty, dear? We're talking. And she said, that woman, she was pretty. I saw you. Okay, but see, I've been married long enough to know that I need to ask, you saw me do what? She might not know, you know, there's a possibility, so I'm not getting ready to confess. This ain't Perry Mason, I watched enough of that, you know, so I ain't confessing yet. So, yeah, I saw you. You saw me, what, dear? I saw you look at her. She was pretty, huh? You're busted. Yep. Now answer. Tell me the truth. I said she wasn't pretty. No, fine. That was the wrong answer. That was the wrong answer. Yeah, I got a combination real quick right there on the ball. You know, I'm not talking about a meal. You already know what I'm talking about. Right? No, it was with a fist. You know this. Pow! Like, okay. Did I deserve that?
Yeah.
For telling the truth?
For everything.
So anyway, and she said, "You know who that was?" I said, "I don't know who that was. I just know that was a beautiful woman." She said, "That was Rihanna. She was here for a concert." I said, "You know, I'd only seen her on television. You know, just yeah. You know, anyway." So the Holy Spirit will keep you from falling even deeper. But then he'll pick you up, and then he's going to erase all that other stuff. I mean, that happens at Pentecost. I become a witness. I become a qualified witness. That's the power that I get.
Amen.
I go from salvation, from Passover to Pentecost, but that's just the down payment.
Amen.
It's not everything. There's more. The more is that he wants you to get into his presence. You got to get into the Holy of the Holies. The problem with the Holy of the Holies is that it's 10 by 10 by 10. It's only enough room because of the furniture that's in there, the mercy seat, the Ark of the Covenant, and the mercy seat that covers it, and with the cherubs that cover even the mercy seat. There's only enough room in that space for one man, and only the high priest can go into that room.
Amen.
Only the high priest is permitted to go in there, but I've got to get in there. How do I get in there? How do I get in? Jesus said that the place that where I am, this is the place where you need to be. So the only way that I can get in is that I got to put on Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
I got to put on Jesus. And when I put on Jesus, then I become an heir to everything that belongs to him. I get access to everything that belongs to him when I put him on. I got to put him on the way that Jacob put on Esau.
Yes.
In order to get the inheritance. Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Okay. All right, so I don't have time to tell you the whole story, but the thing is that Isaac needed to bless his son. He's going to bless Esau, but Jacob had to get that blessing because it was supposed to be connected to Jacob. But Isaac told Esau, "This is what I need you to do, and you know, go out and prepare this meal, you know, that I really like. You know, give me that gumbo." You know, give me that gumbo, you know, to get that. He doesn't say gumbo, but it was this meal that he really liked. So his mother heard it and said, "Okay, well, I need the blessing to go to my son. So to you, the baby, it's like you're the favorite. You're connected to me." And so this is what you do. And Jacob was like, "Mom, but he's going to know it's me. Esau is hairy and smelly. He's rough. Even his voice, everything about it. He's going to know it's me. Instead of blessing me, he's going to curse me, and I'm going to be messed up." And so his mom says, "You know, if he curses you, then that curse be on me. You're going to be fine. Now do what I said. Go and bring me these. You know, go and get these kids, you know, these goats, and then I want you to kill them, and then I want you to bring me the fur." And then she made sleeves from the wool and put them on his arms and around his neck. And then she took the clothes of his brother. She took the clothes of Esau and put it on Jacob. And when she put those clothes on him, and then she prepared this meal, and she took it, and she had him take it, and he said, "Because daddy's blind, you know, he can't see, he won't be able to tell." And so Isaac said, "Okay, you sound like Jacob. Come closer." So when he got closer, then he smelled him. But because he's now wearing his clothes, "You sound like Jacob, but you smell like Esau. He touched you." Every place that he touched. And so because now, even though he still sounds like somebody else, but now you have put on your brother, "I'm going to release the blessing of your brother to you." And so we put on Jesus.
Amen.
We put on the righteousness of Jesus, the helmet of salvation, the sword. We got the word. We got the breastplate of righteousness. Our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. the loins girded about with truth, all this, this is just Jesus. We put on Jesus and we put him on, and now we go to the Father, and the Father says, you sound like Jerome. But you look like Jesus.
Okay.
Everything in the kingdom, every devil, every demon says, mm-hmm. you sound like Jerome. But you look like Jesus. And you're wearing the authority and the reputation of Jesus.
Right.
So we're going to do whatever it is that you say.
Amen.
Man, I really want to get to the inheritance. What it means to be a joint heir with Jesus Christ.
Come on.
Everything that he has, you have access to, not because you earned it, but because you said yes to him.
Mm-hmm.
It's an inheritance. The only thing he had to do was to die. And because he died, he empowered the will. But because he got up, and he got up as a human, he became a partaker of his own will. And we're now joint heirs. Today, right now, you are a son of God. Right now. Because you said yes. I got to stop. You know, even though they told me to take my time, I got a bunch of notes to go to, but I'm not going to get to them. Not this week. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you. Holy Spirit, thank you for this word. Thank you for teaching us. Thank you for talking to us today. Thank you for encouraging us. Thank you for the hope. Thank you for your presence. I ask you, because you are the teacher, to give us a greater understanding, a greater revelation of the very specific things that you had for us. Just give us more. Keep this word fresh as we go throughout the day. Teach us even as we lay down, and remind us when we get up everything we needed to know. In Jesus' name. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, or you need to know him, you need to come back, you want to come home, would you just lift your hand up? You're watching, you're saying, listen, I need to know him. I need him. Just let me know. This is what you do. The scripture says that with the heart, man believes unto righteousness. So by the time you even said, okay, I want to know him, I want Jesus, I need him, according to the word of God, because this is what you desired, you're born again. But now you need more. You got the salvation. Now you need the Holy Spirit. If you need to receive the Holy Spirit today, would you just slip your hand? All of us need the Holy Spirit. If you need to receive the Holy Spirit, I see you. Anybody else, I see your hand as well. Anybody else, you need to receive the Holy Spirit. You haven't received him before, but you want to receive him right now. Jesus said, all you got to do is ask. So let's just pray with me. Say, Father,
you said in your word,
when I ask for the Holy Spirit,
you'll give him to me.
I ask
and receive him
by faith
in Jesus' name.
Glory to God. Congratulations. It's not about a feeling. It's always about your faith. This is the day that you have received the Holy Spirit. Now, if you need to be connected someplace, and you need to be connected someplace, if you're watching over the internet, you're saying, I don't have a church home where I am, but you need to find a place, we can help you find a place in your location. If you're here and you're saying, you know what, I've been coming out, well, none of us have been here in 16 months, but if you're coming out now and you're saying, listen, I need to connect, I want to commit someplace, this is the place where I need to be. Let us know. Just let me know. Let me know. We're going to get some information to you. And I tell you what, if you just give me 1 year, give me 1 year to speak into your life, 1 year, you can write this date down. What today is the 11th of July. I guarantee you that if you would continue to position yourself, come out on Sundays and tune in on Wednesdays. We're still on Zoom. On Zoom on Wednesdays for now. But you tune in and you receive the word and you do all you can to apply that word and walk in it. I guarantee you that by this time next year, your life won't look anything like it does right now.
Mm-hmm.
I guarantee. Been offering that guarantee for, 15, 16 years. And not one person has made it beyond here before they saw change. Most of it happens within a matter of months. Yeah, one person made it, 51 weeks but she made it.
Amen.
Praise God.
Well, I thank God for you. I thank God for you. Did you get anything today?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Praise God. Well, I thank God, and even for this time, it's time for us to sow. So it's offering time. If you brought a tithe or your offering and you're ready to give, if you're online and you want to give, you can do that. You can even do a Cash App. You can send a Cash App. Or what is that? That's the $JT7000. JT7000. There's some other methods, but just contact us. Or you can do it the old-fashioned way. There are some people who still, I shouldn't call it old-fashioned. But you can just do it by, you can send a check. You can mail your check to 7000 Franklin Boulevard, Suite 560, Sacramento, California, 95823. I just encourage you, whatever it is that the Holy Spirit has already spoken to you to give, then just do that. Do that. Get a vision. Get a vision of the seed. What's the finished product? What is it that the Lord has promised? What are you sowing? Get a vision of that. Go ahead and lift your offering. Just hold it, and I want you to, with that vision. Father, I set my faith in agreement with the obedience of your son, your daughter, your children. You've told them what to do, and they've done. So I speak to the seed now, and I command it to go. And I call in the harvest off of that seed. And that your name be glorified. In Jesus' name.